Well, that was pitiful. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that was much better. Well, happy first day of Advent. And so it begins. Decorations. How many of you have trees up in your house already?
Praise and thank you for that this morning. It's why we gather in this room.
this morning, Lord, let words of man fall away. And just bring blessing and power to your scripture, to the celebration of you. In Jesus' name, amen. So let me say this. I'm going to give you a lot of words this morning. It's what I do. And I always worry that you're going to tune me out. I don't have any control over that. You're going to tune me out. But it is my prayer that maybe I give you something today that you can take with you over these next few weeks, and that Christmas can look a little different, maybe a little meaningful. So week one of Advent, which is the week we kick off today. If you were in church, we did it, we lit a candle. Week one is typically called the week of hope or the week of prophecy. Biblical hope is the belief that God is faithful and he keeps his promises. In the Old Testament, what were they waiting for? They needed a savior. Why? Because Adam and Eve brought sin into the world. And once sin came, the world became a dark and ugly place. So all throughout the Old Testament, God gave prophecies or clues for the people so that they would know when the Messiah was coming. In the book of Daniel, it says, "The God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever." So for the Israelites in the Old Testament, they were conquered, they were enslaved, they were rescued, they were reconquered, they were always disobedient, they were given judges, they were ruled by corrupt kings, and all the while, they waited and they hoped for the Savior, that he would come. And then Isaiah told them, he said, "The Lord will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. We'll call him Emmanuel, God with us." Now I'm sure when they heard that, a little bit of a mystery, but as I was pondering this, I thought, boy, I wonder if every pregnant woman didn't wonder, could I be carrying the Messiah? They would be overlooking the virgin part of the scripture if they were pregnant, but nonetheless, it was probably in the back of their mind. Because you see, in the Old Testament, all of the Israelites were hoping that whatever it was God was going to do was going to happen in their lifetime. And if you go through the Old Testament, there are quite literally hundreds of prophecies about God's plan. And these prophecies were an encouragement and they were a hope to the Israelite people as they endured hardships and exiles and captivity. And they trusted God. So what does that have to do with you this morning? Well, we are now the Israelites. Because we sit in this room, and we too wait. Only we no longer wait for the birth, we wait for the return. And all of us in this room, and Kristen mentioned it this morning, we know that this world is a dark and ugly place. I don't have to tell you that children are sold for sex, and their bodies are used in horrific ways. I don't have to tell you that in Iraq, children whose parents are Christians are having their heads chopped off instead of their parents, so their parents will renounce their faith. And then those heads are used for sport. And it's on video, and you can watch it online if you want to. I don't have to tell you that in India and other parts of the world, there are children who are literally born in garbage dumps. And they will live their whole life in that garbage dump, never leaving it. They will never see anything besides that. You've all seen pictures on TV of what a hungry child looks like. Those emaciated little bodies that you want to close your eyes, but it's like, how does it happen? How can you be that hungry? We know that there are innocent people in this world declared guilty. We've all seen pain, suffering, and death. And we ask ourselves, why?
You know what? The Israelites asked the same question
because the world was just as ugly in the Old Testament as it is today. And they were like, where are you, God? We're waiting. We're waiting for you to come and do something about it. And we too have been given prophecies about what God is going to do about everything I just told you. God has addressed every one of those things. He says he will deliver the needy who cry out. He said the afflicted who have no one to help, he will take pity on. God says he will rescue us from oppression and violence. For precious is their blood in his sight. God says, the eyes of the blind will be opened, the ears of the deaf shall hear, the lame shall walk, the mute shall shout for joy. So intellectually, we may know and hear that God is going to come back and that God is going to right these wrongs. But sometimes that doesn't feel good enough. And we get impatient. And we forget that, oh yeah, we're not God. And God actually addresses this in the scripture. He says, I am not slow in keeping my promises. So when you think God is taking a long time to come and do something about it, God says right back to you, I'm not slow about it, as some understand slowness. Instead, I am patient, not wanting anyone to perish, and everyone to come to. So week one of Advent is a reminder that we have hope because God does what he says. And all of the ugliness in the world, God will make right. It may not be in our time, and it may not be in our way, but God knows so much more than us. And so when we sing the very traditional words this season, O come, Emmanuel, familiar song, will they just be words to you? Will you just think about the tiny baby? Or will you really be thinking, God, I want you to come back? That's what we're waiting on. We're waiting on the return of the new heaven, the new earth. So week two, which will begin next week, is Bethlehem, or the peace candle. The prophet Micah said, but you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me the one who will be ruler of Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. So we all know Bethlehem was a little tiny blip on the map. And yet God made it so two teenagers got to this town in his timing, and he used the most powerful man in the world, Caesar, to get there. More than 700 years before Jesus was born, Micah predicted, or prophesied, with complete accuracy, the location, Bethlehem, the lineage, Judah, and the purpose, salvation. And that came to be. And it's interesting that God didn't choose big, bustling Jerusalem, rather obscure Bethlehem, for the Prince of Peace to be born into the world. And we often, as a culture, and sometimes as a church, misinterpret this idea of Prince of Peace. You see, we think that it means peace on earth, no war, no conflict. If he's really the Prince of Peace, if he really gives us peace, then why is there such horror in the world? Well, peace on earth is not the absence of conflict. In fact, Pope John Paul VI, I think, said it best. He said, if you want peace, you work for justice. Justice, however, is not just fair laws and political rights. But it's an interior justice that the Bible calls righteousness. You see, biblical peace that we get from the Prince of Peace is the result of a right relationship with God. And it's unrelated to the circumstances around us. It's not an absence of trouble. Rather, it is a quiet in one's heart that can only come as a gift from God. So, as Bethlehem, so many years ago, unknowingly prepared for the birth of the Christ child, we knowingly can prepare over these next few weeks our hearts to push out the busyness, the commercialization, the stress, the family drama, if it exists, the finals that can define Advent. And we sing words that remind us of that. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie, yet in thy dark streets shineth thee. Everlasting light. Oh my. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. You guys may need to get your Christmas carol down. Okay, so week three. Week three in an Advent wreath is the pink candle. Week three is often referred to as Gaudete Sunday. Anybody know what Gaudete means in Latin? Think about change. Gaudete means joy. Joy. And the pink candle is also called the shepherd's candle. So the scripture says, and the shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring good news of great joy for all the people. So God announced the anticipated Messiah to the lowly, the insignificant, and the unclean shepherds. And the world, who considered them nothing, were the first to hear about the magnificence of the Christ child. This was a moment of great celebration. All the years of waiting had come to fruition on that first Christmas. The Savior was here, the wait was over. And we rejoice in that today because we know the answer to the brokenness of the world has been given. And we rejoice because the joy of the Lord cannot be touched by anything in this world. Because joy, just like peace, is a supernatural gift from God. It is given to you if you believe in Him. And if you were in a right relationship with God, you were automatically filled with His joy and His peace. Now joy, don't confuse it with happiness. People often do. In fact, the Hebrews tells us, Jesus, for the joy set before Him, endured the cross. So joy is not about happiness. Now, we all know the story of this little green guy up here. I think that should be a familiar image to you. He did not want Christmas to come. He said, the noise, the feasting, and of course, what he liked least of all, because every who down in Whoville, the tall and the small, would stand close together with Christmas bells ringing. They would stand hand in hand, and the who's would start
singing.
Oh, thank you. A lot of you guys know your
dreams,
but not your church
song. So what does this green guy do? Well, he gets an idea. An awful idea. A terrible, awful idea. He packed up their presents, the ribbons, the wrappings, the tags, and the tinsel, the trimmings, the trappings. You see, he believed that if he took all the stuff, he would take the joy out of Christmas. That was his goal. However, when he gets all the stuff, with his dog Max, gets it clear up to the top of the mountain, the story says he bends over and puts a hand to his ear because he can't wait to hear all the who's. He's going to take joy in their suffering. Well, the story tells us he did hear a sound rising over the snow. It started in low. It started to grow. But the sound wasn't sad. Why, the sound was quite merry. He stared down at Whoville. Every who down in Whoville. Bill, the tall and the small, was without any presents at all. You see, he hadn't stopped Christmas from coming. It came, somehow or other, just the same. And the Grinch stood puzzling and puzzling. How can it be so? It came without ribbons, it came without tags, it came without packages, boxes, or bags. So he puzzled for hours, till his puzzler was sore. And the Grinch thought of something he hadn't. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Perhaps Christmas means a bit more. You see, Christmas is actually all about a gift, just not a store. It's about the greatest gift ever given. Who is the embodiment of joy. And joy, as I said, is the fruit of the Spirit, freely and lavishly given to each one of you in this room, if you choose to accept it. And that's why we sing the words, joy to the world. That's right. Let earth receive her. Let every heart prepare him. Room, let heaven and nature sing. Thank you. So then we get to week four. We're almost to Christmas at this point. That's called the love candle or the angel candle. One of the most detailed descriptions of angels come from the book of Daniel. This is how he describes the angel he encounters. I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen with a belt of fine gold around his waist. His body was a golden luster, his face the appearance of lightning. His eyes were like flaming torches. His arms and legs gleamed of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words was like the sound of the multitude. So obviously, angels in scripture are not the short, fat, heart-playing, little stubby-winged things we often see. In fact, angels in scripture shut the mouths of lions. They fought wars. They opened prison doors. They were messengers, ministers, hosts, and even a choir. And God gave angels the privilege of being the very first to announce the Savior had been born. And as soon as they made the announcement, they praised God for it. Why would they do that? Because they knew that love, like the world has never known, has entered the world. A love that can meet every need. You see, sin is why bad things happen in this world. And we can try and try and try, but we cannot put the broken world back together again. It's impossible. One of the early Peanuts comic strips, and you'll be able to see this, it's an early one. There's Charlie Brown and a friend, and Snoopy. And they say, look, Snoopy looks kind of cold, doesn't he? The other one says, well, I'll say so. Maybe we'd better go over and comfort him. So what do? Give good cheer, they say to him. And then they walk away. And Snoopy's left. You see, they noticed Snoopy had a need. What was his need? He was cold. So he needed someone to make him not cold. And what did they give him? They gave him words. Were they nice words? Sure, they gave him nice words, but did it meet his need? Absolutely not. You see, without Jesus, the needs of this world will never be met. We will never stop wars. We will never save all of the children from the garbage heap, from starvation. We will never be able to end all disease. And of course, we will never stop death. But Jesus came, and he brought with him love. And that love battled sin and death. And that is why we sing the song, "Born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald and angels sing, glory to the newborn." And then traditionally, the middle candle is lit on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, depending on church tradition, and it's called the Christ candle. And the scripture tells us, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined." The birth of Jesus brought light into the world, and it pierced the darkness of sin and death. John tells us, "In Jesus is life, and this life is the light of men." So if you walk in Jesus, you are given a light that gives you eternal sight. Lots of framing there. In other words, you know that God is coming back. He came once, and when he comes again, will be to make all of us new. And we are to hope for that. See, ultimately, these next 4 weeks, Advent, they're a celebration of truth. They are the truth that God is who he says he is, the Creator. God does what he says he will do, send a Savior and conquer death. And it is the truth of what God will do, and that is come. So lastly, this morning, Kristen, can you throw me the matches? I thought we would at least light the candles. Oh, they're in my purse, right by your feet.
Okay.
Sorry, I knew I forgot something this morning. You could just dig in there and throw them to me. So typically, if you've ever noticed candles, the Christ candle is white. Why do you think the Christ candle is white? Purity. Why is the pink candle pink? Joy. And then the purple candle, actually, typically the color is blue, but it has morphed into purple over the years because apparently purple wax is easier to make than blue wax. And purple is just two things. It stands for royalty, because Jesus is king, and it also stands for repentance. So on Advent, what we did this morning is we lit the first purple candle, which, does anybody remember what that candle was?
Hope.
Hope. That's right. We lit the hope candle, and that is that God is faithful. As we hope for his return, we can trust that God will do exactly what he said. And the scripture tells us, our citizenship is in heaven. We await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will bring everything, all of the ugliness into this world under his control. And he will transform our lowly bodies, and they will be like his glorious body. And that is the promise. Then we light the second purple candle. What was it? Peace. Somebody was listening. The Prince of Peace has come, and it's peace that exists in chaos. And the scripture tells us, for a child has been born to us, a son given to us, authority rests on his shoulders. He is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Then we light the third candle, which is
joy.
Joy, also referred in the Latin as Gaudete! Maybe we'll come and teach you the song sometime. Joy, a gift God places in our hearts. The scripture tells us to shout for joy to the Lord, worship the Lord with gladness, come before him, and know that he is God. And then, the fourth candle. That's right, the love candle. Let's see if I can not burn myself. The love candle, or the angel candle, obviously love came into the world, sacrificial love. God demonstrated his love for us by what? He died on the cross. That's right. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And then the center candle is?
Christ.
The Christ candle. Jesus candle works just fine. The light of the world came, and he vanquished the darkness. And again, Jesus spoke to them, and he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, will have the light of life. So if you will bow your head, we are going to pray, and some amongst you will also be praying, so don't be shocked.
Gracious God, grant that we may find peace as we prepare for our Lord's birth. May divisions within ourselves and in our families be peacefully resolved. May there be peace in our cities and in the countries around the world. Lord, let us remember that you are the giver of lasting peace, and that you are always with us.
Our King and our Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.